be in Hosea chapter 5 this morning, continuing our walk through the minor prophets. So I not only invite you, but I wholeheartedly encourage you to open your Bible to Hosea chapter 5. If you don't have a Bible, you can find one outside the back door. There'll be a Bible for you. If you don't have a Bible at all, then that Bible is our gift to you, and you can take it with you. Want to welcome all of you this morning as we gather for worship. As many of you know, we have another congregation that meets in Changwon. They meet at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and so we want to welcome them as well. They're going to watch this video later this afternoon. Want to welcome our brothers and sisters in Changwon that are worshiping later this afternoon, and just pray that the Lord would be with them, and just continue to work in them as they seek to glorify Christ in that city as well. And would ask that you continue to pray for them. I know we're supposed to have a picnic, and the weather did not cooperate with us, and we're looking to reschedule that so that the two congregations can get together, can mingle, hang out, and worship together and get to know one another. But ask that you would continue to pray for them out there, that God would continue to bless them, use them to proclaim the gospel. But Hosea chapter 5, let's look there together. Hear this, O priests. Pay attention, O house of Israel. Give ear, O house of the king. For the judgment is for you, for you have been a snare at Mizpah, and a net spread upon Tabor. And the revolters have gone deep into slaughter, but I will discipline all of them. I know Ephraim, and Israel is not hidden from me. For now, O Ephraim, you have played the whore. Israel is defiled. Their deeds do not permit them to return to their God, for the spirit of whoredom is within them, and they know not the Lord. The pride of Israel testifies to his face. Israel and Ephraim shall stumble in his guilt. Judah also shall stumble with them. With their flocks and herds they shall go to seek the Lord, but they will not find him. He has withdrawn from them. They have dealt faithlessly with the Lord, for they have borne alien children. Now the new moon shall devour them with their fields. Blow the horn in Gibeah, the trumpet in Ramah. Sound the alarm at Beth Aven. We follow you, O Benjamin. Ephraim shall become a desolation in the day of punishment. Among the tribes of Israel, I make known what is sure. The princes of Judah have become like those who move the landmark. Upon them I will pour out my wrath like water. Ephraim is oppressed, crushed in judgment, because he was determined to go after filth. But I am like a moth to Ephraim, and like dry rot to the house of Judah. When Ephraim saw his sickness in Judah, his wound, then Ephraim went to Assyria and sent to the great king. But he is not able to cure you or heal your wound. For I will be like a lion to Ephraim and a young lion to the house of Judah. I will tear and go away. I will carry off and none shall rescue. I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face, and in their distress earnestly seek me. This is the word of the Lord. May he be glorified at the reading of his word. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning and we thank you and praise you for the opportunity to enter into your word. And we pray, dear Lord, that as we do, that you would bless this time, that you would teach us and instruct us. Father, that you would encourage us and challenge us, Father. We come this morning to be molded and shaped by your word. We confess the authority of your word over us, Lord. And we pray that through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would convict us of sin and that you would lead us in righteousness. And that, Father, we might leave today encouraged and better equipped to go proclaim the wonders and the glories of Jesus Christ to a world that desperately needs to hear this gospel. Father, we give you this time and we ask that you be glorified in it and that we, your people, would be edified. Bless this time in Christ's name. Amen. Last week, as we looked at Hosea chapter 4, we were made aware of the danger of not knowing God. We began to see how a lack of knowledge was a major problem for the people of Israel. This lack of knowledge, however, we need to keep in mind, is completely and totally one-sided. While the people may stand in ignorance of God, God is by no means ignorant of them. You see, to be known can be an unnerving and troubling and unsettling thing. Right? On one level, all of us desire to be known. Right? And that's because we are people. Right? We are people with personalities, and deep within inside of us is a desire to connect with other people who have personalities, right? We long to be known by people. The other day I was watching the new Spider-Man movie, The Amazing Spider-Man Dos. And in that movie, the main villain, that's Spanish by the way, it's two. The main villain in that movie, played by Jamie Foxx, is this guy who is hungry to be known, right? He feels invisible to everybody around him. And he feels so isolated, and he feels so much pain in his loneliness, right? And as we watch that, we can kind of connect with that. Like we can understand that pain, because we know what it is to want to be known. Like we desire to be known by other people. But if we're honest, there's a limit to how much we want to be known, right? Like we want to be known, we want that connection, but there's a limit to how much we want to be known. Really deep down inside of us, I would say there's a fear, this deep embedded fear in us at the thought or the prospect of being completely known. We have this deep-seated awareness that while we want to be known, we don't want to be totally known. I've experienced this. I'm pretty sure you have. I was thinking about when I was younger, and I was in high school, and I was just a good old fashioned grade A punk. I was kind of a jerk. It's funny, one time I thought to myself, man, I'd like to go back in time and beat myself up, right? But then I saw a video of myself from when I was younger, and I was a lot bigger than I am now. And I was like, man, if I went back in time to beat myself up, chances are my old self would beat my new self up, and then we'd have some kind of weird space-time continuum problems, and it's just, I don't want to get into it, right? But I very clearly remember that, like many of us maybe in high school or at some point in life, you kind of put out this persona, right? You want to be known and you want to be liked, so you create this image, this facade, which you hide behind. And I remember very clearly being at a party one time, kind of sitting in the corner. Not that I was very popular. I had a lot of friends, but I was in the corner. And I remember looking at everybody and thinking, if they really knew who I was, if they really knew what was behind this facade I put up, none of them would like me. None of them would want to be around me. And I don't think it's a stretch to say that fear is in all of us. We want connection, but there's limits to the amount of connection we want. I was reading one pastor's commentary on this text, and he said that he imagines even in a marriage relationship that lasts 40, 50, 60 years, he imagines there's still things that a husband keeps from his wife and that a wife keeps from her husband out of fear. Out of fear that if they really knew this about me or if they really knew that about me, would they still love me? Would they still like me? Would they still want to be around me? And it's this fear, right? This deep-seated reality in all of us that makes God's omniscience so unbelievably terrifying and unsettling. It's this reality that all of us fear being completely and utterly known, that make God's omniscience, his all-knowing nature, so unsettling. Because you see, where we can build walls to keep other people's eyes out, right? We can create a facade, we can create a false reality, we can create some kind of separation between us and people that protects us, right? That keeps them from seeing deeply into us. We cannot protect ourselves from the eyes of the Lord. We cannot hide from His knowledge of us. There is no place that we can go to hide, and there is no place in us that is hidden from the Lord. In the deepest and most realist sense of the word, God knows us. No doubt the ancient Israelites, like many people today, lived under the faulty notion that if we fail to acknowledge God, then certainly God fails to acknowledge us, right? They thought, they must have reasoned in their minds that, hey, if we together, collectively, if we all forget about God, right, then certainly God's going to forget about us. Right? That's the way it's going to work, right? God needs us to acknowledge Him. He needs us to remember Him. So if we fail to acknowledge, if we fail to remember, then certainly God's going to fail to acknowledge and remember us. But although the people of Israel are characterized by a lack of knowledge, the same is not true for the Lord. God knows His people. Their sin and their shame are in no way hidden from His sight. In verse 3, God says, I know Ephraim, and Israel is not hidden from me. For the knowledge of God is this comprehensive and complete knowledge, right? For God to say that He knows Ephraim and that Israel is not hidden from Him is to say that everything about them is absolutely plain and open in His sight. As we read this, it reminds us of what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 4:13, where he says, no creature is hidden from His sight, that's God's sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. Israel might think that their deeds and their sin are done in darkness and no one is seeing these things, but all is bright daylight to the Lord. And in these verses, we see exactly what God knows about His people. If we look at verse 3 and 4, we see that God knows of their defilement, right? He says, I know Ephraim, and Israel is not hidden from me. For now, O Ephraim, you have played the whore. Israel is defiled. Just as a side note, Ephraim is a region, a tribe within the northern kingdom of Israel, and it is used in the scriptures to reference the entire kingdom of Israel. So Ephraim is Israel. And so he says, Israel is defiled, right? The spirit of whoredom is within them. So God knows of their defilement. He knows of their wicked deeds. He sees and knows of their failure to interact and associate with each other in a righteous way. Remember chapter 4, God says, there's not a knowledge of me that is present. There's not righteousness that is present. But instead there's lying and there's murder and there's jealousy and there's bitterness and there's strife. God sees their open unrighteous interpersonal interactions with one another. But not only does He see that, God also sees and knows the things that they do behind closed doors. He sees and knows the sins, the intimate sins that are taking place within their homes, the things that they think no one sees. God knows of their sin and their defilement. He knows of their pride as well. Look at verse 5. The pride of Israel testifies to His face. Israel and Ephraim shall stumble in His guilt. Judah shall also stumble with them. So God knows of their pride and their arrogance. Remember that Hosea is prophesied. His ministry takes place under the golden age of Jeroboam II. Right? This is a time of wealth and prosperity. It's a time of economic growth. It's a time of geographic growth. It's a time of agricultural prosperity. The people are living in the heyday. Right? It hasn't been this good since the kingdom was under Solomon. But despite all the blessings of the Lord, despite the economic growth, despite the agricultural increase, and despite the geographic increase of the nation, the people don't credit the Lord for their blessings. They don't come humbly and bow before the Lord and thank Him that He is pouring out so richly upon them. They don't come before God and declare that all that they have is because of Him. No, they credit themselves, right? They look to themselves and say, look what we have built. Look what we have constructed. They're not much different than Nebuchadnezzar, who walks around the great city of Babylon, right? And he says, look what I have built. Look what I have put together. And even worse, not only do they credit themselves for all that they have, they credit their false gods. Remember, worship of Baal has been a problem for the Israelites ever since they entered the Promised Land. If we go back to the book of Joshua, they were told to drive everybody out. And the reason they were told to drive everybody out is because the Lord knew if anybody remained, His people would be tempted and led into false idol worship. And now this reality has come true. And the people are mixing their worship with the worship of the Lord with this worship of Baal. Now Baal is a fertility god, and he's seen as a god of the weather. And so as they look at their fertile land, and as they look at their favorable weather, they're not honoring the Lord, but they're honoring themselves. And even worse, they're honoring Baal, a false god, an idol which they have hewn with their own hands and put together. They bow down and say, thank you for giving us such great things. So God knows of their sin and their defilement. He knows of their pride and their arrogance. He knows of their empty and faithless worship. Look at verses 6 and 7. With their flocks and herds, they shall go to seek the Lord, but they shall not find him. He has withdrawn from them. So they still have this kind of feigned, empty worship. Remember, Isaiah and Hosea are contemporaries with one another. And Isaiah opens up in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 10 through 20, declaring that the people of Israel are bringing false and empty worship that the Lord despises and hates. And then in verse 7, he says they have dealt faithlessly with the Lord. They have borne alien children, children who do not honor and know the Lord, but children who are alien to him. Now the new moon shall devour them with their fields. So God sees their faithless worship. They come to the Lord, but they don't come with a pure heart. They don't come with a desire to grow in righteousness and understanding. They don't come with a desire to know God and to be known by him. They come with this empty and faithless attitude, almost walking through the motions, thinking that they're doing what they're supposed to be doing to check off some religious list. It's hypocrisy at its height. And they come even worse with a mixed heart, for on one hand they offer sacrifices in honor to the Lord, and with the other they offer sacrifices in honor to Baal. And so God sees their faithless worship. And lastly, God knows of their total lack of faith and dependence upon him. If we remember, if you were here as we walked through the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews, the call of the book of Hebrews, the continual clarion call of that book is to be faithful, right? He says, let us be people of faith. Let us not be like the faithless generation of Israelites, but let us be faithful. And the idea of faith, as we talked about last week, is this idea of conviction, of firmness, right? A dependence upon the Lord, a firm commitment to God. And what God sees is he sees the total lack of faith and dependence of his people. If we look at verse 13, when Ephraim saw his sickness and Judah his wound, then Ephraim went to Assyria and sent to the great king, but he is not able to cure you or to heal your wound. God sees and knows how in times of distress and trouble, his people are not turning to him, but rather they are turning to pagan nations. Both Israel and Judah at different points in history had cried out and called out to Assyria and to Egypt as well to deliver them and to save them in times of hardship. In fact, Israel and Judah enter into a war. Some people think that this is a slight reference to that. But they enter into a war at one point where Judah cries out for Assyria to come help them fight against the Israelites. And so God looks at him, and his people understand they're in distress. His people understand they're in trouble. And instead of crying out to him, instead of depending on him, instead of trusting in him, they look to a pagan nation and to a pagan king to deliver them. How sad, how depressing, how low have they sunk that they have forgotten the God who has delivered them from the Egyptians. The God who delivered them from slavery, the God who delivered them through the wilderness, the God who opened up the Red Sea before them, the God who fed them with manna in the wilderness, the God who caused quail to drop out of the sky, the God who brought water from a rock. How quickly they have forgotten, how low they have sunk, that the God who provided for them and cared for them, the God who delivered them, they no longer trust. They no longer depend on him, they no longer look to him, but instead they turn their attention, their trust, and their dependence to a pagan king. And God sees and he knows all of this. While they think this is hidden, and while they think they covered up, and while they think their deeds are done under the cover and the protection of darkness, it is bright and shining daylight before the Lord. And he knows all of it. Despite the people's lack of a knowledge of God, God fully knows his people. And it is here that we must admit that the same holds true for us. We are no less concealed before the Lord than those who went before us. Our lives stand as open books before God. Our sin, despite our best attempts to cover it, to hide it, to ignore it, to push it aside, to sweep it under a rug, is plain as day before God. And we have to keep in mind that it's not just Israel that God knows fully. It's not just the church that God knows fully, but God knows all people fully. If we go back to the first two chapters of this, or two, first two verses, he says, "Hear, O priests, pay attention, O house of Israel, give ear, O house of the king, for judgment is for you, for you have been a snare at Mizpah, and a net spread upon Tabor, and the revolters have gone deep into slaughter, but I will discipline all of them." We're looking at these two verses, we see there is no partiality before the Lord, right? God shows no partiality. Your place or your position in life means nothing before the Lord. In fact, God says, "I will judge, I will discipline all of them." Even if one fails to acknowledge God, is no protection from Him. We must never forget that God stands as creator and sustainer over the universe, which means that all things in creation belong unto the Lord, and all things in creation are accountable to the Lord. Whether we choose to acknowledge God or not, one of the greatest misconceptions that probably plagued the Israelites and that plagues people today is that God needs us to believe in Him. I watch too many movies, and I've got to stop. But if you ever watch Wrath of the Titans or Clash of the Titans, right? It's a good movie, right? It's a guy running around beating up stuff, mythical stuff. How fun is that, right? He's slaying mythical dragons and beasts and doing all kinds of mythical cool stuff. But it's Prometheus and he's fighting the bad people. Just watch it. But the main thing is you've got these gods, right? The gods of Olympus, Zeus and Hades and Ares and all these guys, and it's starting to crumble. It's starting to fall apart. And the reason it's crumbling and the reason Olympus is falling apart is because the people aren't praying anymore. The people have decided to withhold their devotion. The people have decided to withhold their praise. They've decided to withhold their honor, their sacrifices. And so the gods are falling into disarray, right? Their temples are ruined. And their godly home, Olympus, is crumbling. And today, I can't help but think that so many people think that way, right? They think that if I fail to acknowledge God, He will cease to exist. He's like the tooth fairy, right? If I don't believe in the tooth fairy doesn't exist. He's like Santa Claus. If I don't believe in Santa Claus doesn't exist. But the sad reality is that God is in no way dependent upon you for belief. He doesn't need you to believe in Him to exist. He doesn't need your worship and praise to sit enthroned upon the heavens and the earth be His footstool. He is. And if anybody in creation is dependent, we are the dependent ones. And what that means that God stands as creator and sustainer of all things, and because all creation owes Him and is accountable to Him, that means that the atheist who denies God, right? The atheist who laughs, who scoffs at the idea of a supreme being who sits enthroned upon the heavens is no less accountable to God than the Christian who grew up in church. Paul says in Romans 3:19 that all creation stands accountable unto the Lord. And the scary and frightening reality is not only do we stand accountable to the Lord, but absolutely nothing about our lives is hidden from Him. I want you to think for just a moment. Think over your life. Some of you have more to think over than others, so I'll give some time. I was teaching for my good friend, my good Canadian friend, I won't say his name, but I was teaching for him, a group of children, which to me is like torture. I don't like teaching little kids. And they asked me, they said, I was just kind of warming up, and I said, "How old do you think I am, Teacher Dan?" One girl said, "Yeshit." I thought, that's pretty cool, I'll take that, I'm not 20. Right? But I said, "I'm 35," and they said, "Oh, Michael Teacher 35? I said, no, Michael Teacher old. So old. 45, right? They're like, "No." They're like, "Yeah, he's old guy, right?" So some of us have more to think over, right? We've got a lot more to think over. Think over your life. Think of some of the things you've done in your life. Think of some of the things that you've worked to hide. Think of some of the things that you've even worked to hide from yourself. We're all that way. There's things that we've done, memories that we have that we don't want to remember, that we don't want to know anymore. And we try to hide them from ourselves. Now imagine the fact that none of that is hidden from the Lord. But He sees it all and He knows it all. And not like we see and know things. We went out to eat with Annie's friend from middle school, from elementary school. Annie hasn't seen this girl in 18 years. And so memories are fuzzy, right? And so we're eating out, and her friend's like, well, do you remember so-and-so? And Andy's like, ah, I kind of remember the name, but I can't bring a face. See, sometimes for us, memories are fuzzy. Like, ah, I kind of remember doing this thing, but I don't remember exactly what I did. But nothing is fuzzy for the Lord. Nothing is a vague memory, but it's crisp, and it's before him, and he sees it, and he knows it. And if that is not a terrifying truth, then I don't know what is. And to me, it's unbelievably terrifying and frightening because I know the depth of my depravity. I know the depth of my sin. I know the things that I've done that I don't want anybody to know. And to be honest with you, the reality that God sees and knows all, the reality that I am an open book before him is a truth and a terrifying truth, which can only be eased by the reality of the cross. One of my favorite songs to sing, one of my absolute most favorite songs to sing, and one which I always cry at this one, is written by a guy by the name of Horatio Spafford. Anybody know Horatio Spafford? It's a popular name. It's coming back, making its way back with kids. I think it's like, you know, the number two on the names list. It's my son Horatio. You don't know Horatio Spafford. But maybe you know the song, It Is Well With My Soul. You know that song? Absolutely beautiful song. So beautiful. Possibly the only thing that makes it more beautiful is the story that's behind it. But there's a line, the third stanza of Horatio Spafford's hymn goes like this. My sin, or the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. You see, the reality that God fully knows us, the reality that he sees deeply into us, the reality that nothing is hidden before his sight is a terrifying truth that can only be eased by the cross. Because it's only in coming to Jesus Christ through faith and repentance that all the sin that is inside of us is nailed to the cross with Christ. And what the Father now sees and what the Father now knows is that all those who are in Christ Jesus are clothed in his righteousness. That all those who are in Jesus Christ, their sin is forgiven, washed away by the blood of Christ. And our Father says he remembers it no more. He says as far as the east is from the west, he removes it from us. And so this morning, if you don't know Christ, if you're not a Christian, if you've never repented of your sins and come to Jesus, then I beg with you and I plead with you to stand in absolute fear and dread that you are completely and utterly and totally naked and exposed before the eyes of God. Though you might try to hide your sin, though you might try to cover it up, that you might try to conceal your iniquity and your wickedness, God sees it and he knows it all, and in his righteousness and his holiness, he has promised that he will judge it. And I pray that you will be shaken by that truth. I pray that you will be undone by that truth, and that because of that, you will run to Christ. That you will know that it is only in Christ and through Christ that we can stand forgiven. We can know that we know that it's only in Christ and through Christ that being known by God is no longer a terrifying reality, but a wonderful and blessed and true reality. We want to be known, fully known by Christ, by our Father, by the Lord, in and through Jesus Christ. It's only through Christ that we can be free from our sin and our guilt. And it's only through Christ that we can join Horatio and say, praise the Lord, my sin is nailed to the cross and I bear it no more. Given the reality that God knows them, even in light of their decided lack of knowledge, we would be right to wonder why this truth alone does not drive the nation of Israel to repentance. The answer comes in the rather confusing words that we read in verse 4. In verse 4, God says, their deeds do not permit them to return to their God. For the spirit of whoredom is within them, and they know not the Lord. What we see here in verse 4 is that the deeds of Israel have not only defiled them, but they have totally and utterly incapacitated them. God declares that the deeds of his people prevent them from returning or prevent them from repenting. The sin of the people, which began as this flirtatious dalliance, has now grown into a full-blown adulterous affair. Right, go back to the story that frames this for us, right? Go back to the story of Hosea and Gomer, which sets this up for us. And we think of Gomer, this wayward wife, right? This wife who is going to prove to be unfaithful, and she's got this temptation inside of her, this sin inside of her to feed her own lusts and her desires. Right? I was reading John Owen last night, and if you don't know John Owen, then you need to start reading him. Fantastic gentleman, he's dead. But he's great. Actually, he's not dead. I guess he's in heaven, so he's alive. So, yay for him. But John Owen says something very interesting when he's talking about the power and the nature of indwelling sin. And he says, temptation never puts anything into us. It only entices and draws out what's already there. And so we think of Gomer, who has this sin, this lust inside of her. And we think of maybe the first time she sees another gentleman at the market as she's walking along. And she finds him to be handsome, to be attractive. And the lust and the sin inside of her begins to pull her and tempt her to pursue him. And maybe at first she denies that temptation. Maybe at first she refuses it. But time after time after time, temptation is tugging and it's pulling on that sin inside of her. It's calling her to forsake Hosea, to run after her lusts and her passions, to fulfill them and satisfy them with these men that she's encountered, and eventually becomes too strong and she runs after them. And maybe at first she feels the sting of what she's done. Maybe at first she realizes, wow, what have I done? What have I done? I've betrayed my husband. I've slept with another man. I should return home. I should go back to him. But the more she gives in to the temptation, the more numb she becomes to that feeling. And sooner than later, she becomes a slave to that temptation. She becomes a slave to that sin, and she no longer feels the pain of what she's done to her husband, or the sting of what she's done to her family. And then we see where it ends up in Hosea 3, where her sin has driven her to slavery. It's driven her to the auction block, naked and exposed, being sold as property before the city. And the same holds true with Israel. They begin these flirtatious ideas and these flirtatious interactions with the Baals, with the false gods, and with their own temptations and sins that dwell inside of them. But eventually those flirtatious dalliances, those kind of secret rendezvous, they become more frequent and more often, until eventually they are so deeply in bed with these false gods, so deeply in bed with their own pride, their own arrogance, and their own sin, that there is no way out. They've become completely and utterly enslaved to their sin, so captivated by their sin that they are unable to repent and return, so in love with their sin that they are unable to return to the Lord. Their minds, being devoid of a knowledge of God, are set firmly on sin and the flesh. And Paul tells us in Romans, in chapter 8, what such a mind is capable of. Paul says, "For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit of is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot." Those who are on the flesh cannot please God. Minds that are set on the flesh, minds like the minds of the Israelites that are set on their sin and their rebellion and their lusts, are unable to submit to the law of God. They're unable to return. They cannot submit to God. The flesh and the spirit are opposed to one another, and the minds of the Israelites are firmly entrenched and set on sinful fleshly lusts and desires. They have not the spirit of God in them, but rather, as God says in Hosea, a spirit of whoredom. So the question comes, right? If their minds are firmly entrenched and set on the flesh, if they are so in love and in bed with their sin and their sinful desires, how can they repent? How can there be any hope of repentance? How can they return to the Lord if their minds are sold into slavery to sin? And I think the answer for us this morning is found in two places. One is in Ezekiel and one is in John. In Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 through 27, God declares this through his prophet. We need to keep in mind Ezekiel is another prophet, right? And Ezekiel has, if you haven't read Ezekiel, you need to read it. Like maybe late at night when you're super tired, kind of like with some like psychedelic music on in the background, right? Because he just sees some really trippy things, and it's kind of cool, right? So like a little Inagata Devita, and then some Ezekiel, all right? But in Ezekiel 20, don't do that. I don't prescribe that. In Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27, God says this. Actually, start in verse 25 because it's pretty too. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanliness. He's speaking to his people. And from all your idols I will cleanse you, and I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and to be careful to obey my rules. That's Ezekiel 36. In John chapter 3, we read something so very similar to that. In John chapter 3, Jesus is having a discussion with Nicodemus, right? This great teacher of Israel. And Nicodemus is asking him about his teachings. And Jesus says, beginning in verse 3, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Right? Now, let's kind of break this down just a little bit quickly. Seeing the kingdom of God, we could say, is equivalent to being in the kingdom of God, having access to the kingdom of God, which we know through the teachings of Scripture comes about through repentance and faith in Christ. As we repent of our sins and place faith in Christ, we become citizens of the kingdom. This is what Paul says to the church at Philippi. Don't rejoice that you're citizens of Rome. Rejoice instead that you are citizens of the kingdom. Right? So to enter the kingdom of God, to be a citizen of the kingdom of God, only comes about through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. And Jesus says this can't happen unless you're born again. So Nicodemus says, well, how in the world am I supposed to do that? Right? Am I supposed to crawl back inside my mother's womb and be born again? Disgusting, right? Absolutely disgusting. I saw a Will Ferrell skit one time where he was supposed to be a baby that was born, but we'll just talk about that later. Disgusting. Jesus answered and said, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from and where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. So Ezekiel 36 and Jesus in John chapter 3, they say the same thing. That the only way to repentance, the only way to return to the Lord, the only way to come to God is if His Spirit comes inside of us. And Ezekiel, God says, I will put my Spirit within you. In John chapter 3, Jesus says it has to be the Spirit. The Spirit has to come into you. The Spirit has to give you new life. The Spirit has to awaken your eyes to your sin, to see your need for repentance, to see your need for faith in Jesus Christ. So if Israel is to have any hope at repentance, it is not something that they are going to be able to conjure up in their own strength, in their own might, in their own ability. It is going to be a work of the Lord through His Holy Spirit within them. Repentance can only come as the Holy Spirit brings new life to the people. Israel will never be able to return unless and until the Lord puts His Spirit within them. And the truth is that we are no better than they are. Paul declares in Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 18, that there is none righteous, no, not one. Hate to burst your bubble. But in our natural condition, in our natural state, separated from Christ, nobody is righteous. Nobody, Paul says, seeks the Lord. Nobody desires God, but their feet are set on wickedness. Their feet are set on death, not on pursuing Christ, but their feet are set on pursuing sin and death. He says in Ephesians chapter 2 that we are obedient to the spirit of the power of error that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. Outside of Christ, all of us stand absolutely and totally helpless. We are no better than Israel. We cannot repent and return to the Lord unless the Holy Spirit brings new life into our hearts. And here's the thing. Is that we have as much control over the Holy Spirit as we do over the wind. That's what Jesus says. The wind blows where it wants to. We don't know where it comes from. We don't know where it's going, but we know the sound of it. So it is with the Spirit. We have absolutely no control over the Holy Spirit. He goes where He wishes. He does what He wishes. And it's only through Him coming into our life, awakening our hearts, regenerating us, giving us new life, that we have the hope of repentance. And so what we see is we are completely and utterly dependent upon God to move in us if we hope to have repentance. As I was writing this and as I was thinking about this, I kept asking myself over and over. I kept saying, you know, what encouragement, what enticement is there in declaring that we cannot repent, we cannot return to the Lord unless the Holy Spirit moves in us, and that we have as little control over the Holy Spirit as we do over the wind. See, it would be one thing to say, you can't repent unless the Holy Spirit is in you, but you can grab the Holy Spirit and you can put Him inside of you. But that's not what the Bible says. We can't grab the Holy Spirit. We can't command the Holy Spirit. He is God. He is the third person of the Trinity. We can't command Him. We can't demand anything of Him. He is God. And so I kept asking myself, what enticement is there? What encouragement is there in declaring that we can't repent apart from the Holy Spirit and we have no control over the Holy Spirit? What encouragement and enticement is laid upon us as we consider that it's only through His work in our hearts that we have any hope of repentance? And then I realized that the encouragement, the enticement is that it so is within us. This deep-seated understanding of our dependence upon the Lord. Remember Israel. God sees their faithlessness. He sees their lack of dependence. They pursue Assyria for help. They have forgotten that they are totally and utterly dependent upon the Lord for life. And so understanding to a believer, if you're a Christian, if you've repented of your sins, and if you've come to Jesus Christ through faith and repentance, then we need to be reminded and we need to understand that our repentance is not a work that we have created in and of ourselves. It's not something that we have done. The Bible says over and over and over again that God will act and God will do so that God will receive all glory. In fact, the Apostle Paul, as he's working through the argument in the book of Romans, and he comes to chapter 3 where he talks about God putting forward Jesus as a propitiation to be received by faith. He then goes on to say that it is completely and utterly through faith so that all boasting will be removed. And so as a believer, as a believer and a follower of Christ, as we remember that the repentance that we have, and even the repentance that we continue to have, because as a Christian our life should be characterized by repentance, is all a work of the Spirit within us. That we need to be reminded again that we are completely and utterly dependent upon the Lord for our life. That it's not just the initial repentance that we're brought to, but it's our sustaining in that repentance and our continual pursuit of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior is a work of the Spirit within us. I like to read guys named John. So I told you about John Owen. Well, another guy named Jonathan Edwards, right? Jonathan Edwards, he's dead too in heaven with John. They're hanging out together. All the Johns. There's like a special place for all the Johns in heaven, which actually Johns is kind of... Anyway, that's a slang term for something else. this is weird. Jonathan Edwards, I read a sermon by him two nights ago. And the title of it was God's Glory in Man's Dependence. And the whole sermon was about how utterly and completely dependent we are upon God to work in us and through us. And how through that, God receives all glory and honor and praise. And so if you're a believer, if you're a follower of Christ, if you've repented of your sins and you've placed your hope and faith and trust in Jesus Christ, then please understand that this was a work of the Spirit in you. That you had no less opportunity to return than Israel did. Your deeds were no less defiling than their deeds were. And it's because of God's work in you that you are who you are. We are all we are because of Christ. To Him be all glory and honor and praise forever and ever. Amen. May we rest faithfully, joyfully, and willingly in our dependence upon God. May we cry out like the psalmist does, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to You be all glory and honor and praise forever and ever. Amen. Because all that we are and all that we ever will be is a work of Your Spirit within us. What a wonderful, wonderful truth for us to grab onto and hold onto as believers and followers of Jesus Christ, that we are His workmanship, created for good works which He prepared for us in Jesus Christ, that we might walk in them beforehand. If you're not a believer in Jesus, if you're not a Christian, if you've never repented of your sins, then understand this. You cannot change yourself. You cannot change, you cannot end your slavery to sin. Though you might try, though you might make attempts, all you will find is that you are driving yourself deeper and deeper into slavery. I hate to use myself as an example so much, but I know myself the best. And I look back at my life again and I remember this. I remember looking at my life going, I hate everything about this. I despise everything I'm doing. And I remember making efforts to change, trying to end my slavery, trying to end my attachment to these sinful lusts. And what I found out is their strength only became stronger, their grip only became tighter, and my enslavement only became more evident. If you are not a Christian, then understand this. You cannot change yourself. You cannot repent. You cannot earn God's righteousness. It is only through the Holy Spirit. So I encourage you, and I implore you, and I plead with you to cry out to God, to ask Him, to beg Him, to say, Father in heaven, who knows me, who sees me, save me, deliver me, for I am unable to save and to deliver myself. And the wonderful and the beautiful promise of the Lord from Romans chapter 10 is that all who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. You see, we're dependent upon the Holy Spirit, but God is not stingy. Understand that. We are dependent, but He is a gracious and merciful and giving God. He is not stingy. He doesn't stand up there and say, no, 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 Spirit, you can't go. No, forget it. They're crying out to me. They're calling out for repentance. No, forget it. That's not how God is. God says, call on me. Trust in me. Place your faith and your hope and your dependence upon me, and you will be saved. Not might be saved, not maybe be saved. You will be saved. So if you don't know Christ this morning, if you're not a believer, cry out to the Lord. Beg that He would send His Spirit to awaken you, to give you new life, to call you to repentance and faith, and then know that He will. For our God is a good and gracious God, patient and kind, desiring that all might come to repentance. Lastly, what we see in this text, and I'll finish quickly, is we see how God moves sinners to repentance. Let's look at verses 8 through 14, and I'm going to spoil it right now for you before we get to the end. It's through judgment and punishment. Hate to do that. Stay with me, though. They feed on the sin. I'm sorry, I'm back in chapter 4. A wind blew. Verse 8. Blow the horn in Gibeah, the trumpet in Ramah. Sound the alarm at Beth Aven. We follow you, O Benjamin. Ephraim shall become a desolation in the day of punishment among the tribes of Israel. I make known what is sure. The princes of Judah have become like those who move the landmark. Upon them I will pour out my wrath like water. Ephraim is oppressed, crushed in judgment, because he was determined to go after filth. But I am like a moth to Ephraim and like dry rot to the house of Judah. When Ephraim saw his sickness and Judah his wound, then Ephraim went to Assyria, and sent to the great king, but he is not able to cure you or heal your wound, for I will be like a lion to Ephraim and a young lion to the house of Judah. I will tear and go away. I will carry off, and none shall rescue. God uses punishment, judgment upon sin to move His people towards repentance. And He gives us two analogies here. He gives us two pictures of His judgment. All right, first, He says that in verse 12 that He will be like a moth to Ephraim and like dry rot to the house of Judah. I hate moths. I don't know why I hate moths. I haven't quite figured this out yet, because I love butterflies, and they're just like moths' big cousin, right? But it's kind of like the tale of two sisters, right? Like one's really pretty and everybody loves, and the other one's this annoying, ugly thing that just runs around, right? It's like some kind of ancient Aesop's fairy tale or something like that. But I love butterflies. I hate moths. I hate them. They're just nasty things, right? They flutter really fast. They get in your face. They're just annoying. Like, I despise moths. But moths aren't only annoying, right? They're not only frustrating. They're destructive, too, right? Moths can destroy clothing. They can destroy other things. Like, they lay eggs and their larvae. They eat wool or whatever. They're just nasty, right? So you get mothballs, right? I love mothballs. You can always tell who owns mothballs, right? It's like you get on the elevator with somebody, you're like, oh, they own mothballs because they stink. Like, they smell so bad. And then you're like, now I know why moths don't go near mothballs. Same reason I want to be near you right now. This smells awful, right? But moths are not only destructive, but they're also distracting, right? They distract us. But the weird thing about a moth and dry rot is they're both easily remedied and they're both avoidable, right? Like I can get away from a moth, It's not like that's hard, right? Unless it's like a flock of moths, right? Or a gaggle. I don't know what a group of moths is called, but unless a flock of moths is after you. But otherwise, a moth is easy to get away from. Dry rot, that's an easy problem to deal with. It's an avoidable problem, right? So this is interesting. God says I'll be like a moth and like dry rot. Well, what does that mean when you're talking about judgment and punishment? Here's what I believe it means. Is that God begins in punishment and judgment by distracting us and by bringing a certain amount of destruction. Right? Like a moth distracts us. So God, in his initial judgment and punishment in our sin, he distracts us and he just seeks to distract us from what we love and what we're pursuing. Right? Because when we sin, what we're doing is we're saying we love this thing, whatever it is, more than we love God. Right? And we're pursuing it more than we're pursuing God. And so what God does is initially he comes in his love and his compassion and his kindness, and he seeks to distract us from that thing. He seeks to take our eyes off of it, right? Like you're flipping at a moth like this. He seeks to take our eyes off of the thing that we love, to remind ourselves to say, look, you're on a path that leads towards death. Get off of this path, right? But then the distraction doesn't work, right? So then he begins to destroy the thing that we love, right? Whatever that might be, whether it's a relationship, a sinful relationship that we're in, he begins to deconstruct that and eat that like a moth eats something, right? From the inside out, starts to deconstruct it and pull it apart. Right? Dry rot starts and just eats and eats things out. And so God begins to destroy the thing that we love if we don't respond to his distraction. And so I think this is how God works in our lives. And I think most of us can kind of reason with this, right? We can understand this. We've been in a position where we've seen ourselves pursuing some lust, some sin, some desire. And God has graciously and lovingly come along and sought to remind us that we're on a path that leads to death. Again, does it get annoying if I keep using myself as an example? If it doesn't, then some of you, would you come hang out with me? We'll have coffee. I will learn about you and start using you as an example. But I remember being in high school, again, not much of high school, but I was dating this girl, and we were engaged in a relationship that was just completely and utterly sinful. And at the time, I told you I grew up in the belt buckle of the Bible Belt, right? And so I still went to church. I remember sitting, I'm in this big church, we're in a gym because they have to build a new building to house us. God forbid we spread out, and we just got to build a new building. So I'm sitting in this gym, probably 300 people there, and the pastor, who has a dad who has a great Scottish accent, he's teaching about being unevenly yoked. Right? We've all heard that sermon, right? Whether you went to youth group or somewhere, you've heard, don't be unevenly yoked, right? Don't be a believer marrying an unbeliever, don't be a believer dating an unbeliever, these kind of things. I agree with it. I'm not saying I disagree. But I tell you, man, I'm not joking, right? Everybody disappeared. And it was just like me and him were the only two people in this room, right? I don't know how this happened, right? God does cool things, but they didn't really disappear. It's not like David Copperfield. But I get this sense and this awareness that God is, he's talking to me. And I feel that it's just me and this pastor. And I hear God say in my head, it speaks to me audibly, right? What does God sound like? He sounds like you. Just want to throw that out there, right? And so God says to me, Dan, you need to break up with this girl. You need to. The relationship is destructive, it's deadly, and it's leading nowhere. Break up with her. And at that point, maybe we've been together 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, you know? So the pain, not going to be that great, right? I sit there, and as audibly as I'm speaking to you now, I say to God in my head, no. You want it done, you do it yourself. Serious as a heart attack, that's what I said. And what happened was, like moth, like dry rot, God began to destroy that relationship from the inside out. And what I found is that when you have opportunity to pay attention to the moth that distracts and begins to destroy, you save yourself from the lion that waits down the path. Two verses later, God says, I will be a lion to Ephraim. And a young, strong lion to Judah. I will tear them. I will rip them a shred. And I will go back, and none will stop me from carrying them off. You see, because what happens is God comes to us first to distract us, and they begin to destroy the thing that we love. And if we ignore that, if we pursue and persist in spite of that, then comes the lion. And God's judgment and his punishment and his anger and his wrath against sin becomes more evident, more destructive, and more painful. You see, a moth is avoidable. You can get away from a moth pretty easily. A lion? Less so. You ever seen a lion? I haven't seen one in person. Is that, they probably grew up in your backyard, like South Africa, they're everywhere. They have them as pets, for goodness sake, right? It's like you're born, in South Africa, when you're born, you get a baby lion that kind of like is your companion through life. Then you have to hold him up like Simba, right? Basically, Lion King is just, it's just basically like a biography of life in South Africa. But I watch these shows and I marvel at like big cats, right? The big cat. They are massive. Like, they are nothing but muscle. Like if you look at a lion, like they are in the gym 24/7, right? They work out constantly. They are huge. And you don't get away from them. Especially once you're in the jaws of a lion, there's no escape. They will rip you and they will tear you asunder with ease, with great ease. They'll fight, they'll push, but to no avail. You will be destroyed. And that's what God says. He says, if you ignore the moth, if you ignore the dry rot, then the lion waits down the path. And then I will tear you asunder. I will rip you. That relationship that I told God to break up, you know what he did? He did. He ripped it asunder. Until I was reeling and in pain up until the time I met my wife. And I look back on that and I go, how much pain, how much anguish, how much sadness could I have saved myself had I listened? Had I done what I was told? Israel will not listen to Hosea. He will cry out against their sin. He will speak against them, and they will not listen. And in 722 BC, God will send the lion of Assyria, the very nation that they called out to for help, to rip them to shreds, to carry them off into captivity. And no one will be able to rescue them then. The same holds true for us. God works in our lives to distract us and to destroy the things that we love so that we might remember we are on a path that leads to sin and death. If you're a believer, he comes that way so many times to us to remind us of our sin and to call us back to repentance. So if you're a believer this morning, heed that. Heed the moth. Listen to the moth. Pay attention to the moth and go, this path is sinful. Get back on the right path to repentance. If you're not a believer, if you're not a Christian, understand that God is bringing judgment and punishment upon your sin now in measure, now just in measure, to lead you to repentance and faith. But Paul tells us in Romans 2:5 that there is a day of wrath being stored up, a day when his full anger and punishment against sin will be poured out upon us. And in that day, no one shall rescue you. So while God is patient and waiting and kind, repent, cry out for the Holy Spirit, and come to Christ. Because you see, the end of all God's judgment and work is not destruction, but repentance. Verse 15, I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and they seek my face and in distress earnestly seek me. God punishes his people. He judges his people not to destroy them, not to kill them, not to obliterate them, but to lead them to repentance. To lead them to seek him. And in actuality, what we see there and what we need to understand is what we are seeing in the moth, what we are seeing in the lion, is we are seeing God's deep and abiding love for his people. Hebrews says that God chastises and disciplines every son whom he loves. So let us not take lightly the judgment of the Lord. But let us be aware of the moth, lest we run into the lion. Let us repent and return to the Lord and pursue him with all that we are. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we praise you and thank you for your word. We praise you and thank you for Jesus Christ. We praise you and thank you for your truth. We pray, Lord, that you would work in us and through us by the power of your Holy Spirit to live according to your word, that we might glorify and honor you in our existence. We pray, Lord, that we'd be aware of sin in our lives, indwelling sin, Lord. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, we would work to put it to death and to live in righteousness. Father, I pray for all of us in here. I pray for those who are believers, who have repented of their sins and placed their faith in Christ, that they would glorify you and their dependence upon you. That they would be reminded that all that they have and all that they are is because of you. Even their faith is a gift and their repentance, your work in their lives. Father, I pray for those who are not Christians, who do not know Jesus as Lord and Savior, that you would work in their hearts to remind them, to show them the end of their sin, to show them that all that awaits is judgment and punishment, and through that and by that, would you move them to call out upon you, to cry out for your Holy Spirit to come, to redeem them, to save them, to cleanse them, to give them new life, Father. We praise you and thank you for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning,